I'm going to act quite strangely now, and you mustn't be shocked at anything I do. Whatever I may say, you must excuse as part of that deceit I am forced to use. I shall employ sweet speeches in the task of making that impostor drop his mask. I'll give encouragement to his bold desires and furnish fuels to his amorous fires. Since it's for your sake and his destruction, I shall seem to yield to his seduction. I'll count on you, as soon as you've seen the type of man he is, to intervene and not expose me to his odious lust a moment longer than you feel you must. Remember, you are to save me from my plight whenever... Hush, he's coming. Keep up sight.
You wish to have a word with me, I'm told?
Yes. I have a little secret to unfold. Before we speak, however, it would be wise to close that door and check your spies. The very last thing that should happen now is a repetition of this morning's row. That storm has only bettered your position. My husband doesn't have the least suspicion. And now, in mockery of those who do, he bids me be continually with you. And that is why, quite fearless of reproof, I can now be alone with my Tartuffe. Perhaps that why, if not the heart, is too quick to yield, feels free to let its passion be revealed.
Madam, you speak quite strangely now. You spoke in quite a different tone earlier, you know.
Oh, sir, if half refusal made you smart, it's little that you know of a woman's heart. Or what that heart is trying to convey, what it resists in such a feeble way. Always, at first, our modesty prevents the frank avowal of our tender sentiments. However high that passion which inflames us, still, I confess its power somehow shames us. Thus, we are left yet, at first in tone, that what tells you that our heart is overthrown. But our lips deny, our pulse confesses. And then, in time, all no's turn to yeses. But when I tried to force you to undo the marriage plans my husband has with you, what did that urgent being not signify? That I admired you, and that I deplored the thought that someone else should own part of my heart that I wish for my own home?
Madam, no happiness is so complete as when from lips we love come words so sweet. Their nectar floods my every sense, and drains in honey rivulets through all my veins. Your pleasure is my joy, my only goal. Your love is the restorer of my soul. And yet, I must confess, some lingering doubts as to my happiness. Might this not be a trick? Might it not be the catch that you wish to undo the match with Marianne and so are fain to love me? I shan't quite trust your fond opinion of me until these words you've said so sweetly are demonstrated somewhat more concretely.
To make that sweet admission cost me dear, you won't be content, so it would appear, unless my store of favors is dispersed to the last farthing, to the very first.
We trust no promised bliss till we receive it. Not till the joy is ours can we believe it. And I, who so little credit your scheme, can't credit this fulfillment of my dream. And shan't, madam, until I savor some palpable assurance of your favor.
My, how tyrannical your love can be, how it flusters and perplexes me come. Must you hound and carry me to death? Will you not allow me time to catch my breath? Is it right to press me with such force? Give me no quarter, show me no remorse. Take advantage of that stern insistence of the fond feelings which weaken my resistance.
If you look with favor upon our love, why then begrudge me of some clear proof thereof?
But how can I consent to a vow henceforth heaven would you feel such reverence?
Ah! If that is all that holds you back, don't worry, I can remove that hindrance in a hurry. Nothing of that sort can obstruct our path.
Must one not fear heaven's wrath?
Forget such woes, and forget such fears, and be my pupil. I shall teach you how to conquer scruple. It's true some joys are wrong in heaven's eyes, but heaven is not adverse to compromise. You've got a bad cough.
Very bad indeed.
Perhaps a bit of licorice Grace just watched you.
I just can't hold it, seems. Don't take much more vigorish to cure it.
How like it, lady?
Oh, more than I can say!
Well, if you're still troubled, think of things this way. No one shall know our joy save us alone. It's scandal, madam. That makes it an offense. And it's no sin to sin in confidence.
Well, clearly I must do as you require and yield to your impertinent desire. It's apparent now that nothing less will satisfy you, so I will acquiesce. To go so far as much against my will, I'm vexed that you've come to this, but still.
I worry about the man. Each day he grows more gullible. One can meet him by the nose.
Oh, nevertheless, give step out a moment into the hall and see that no one's in it.
That man's a perfect monster, I must admit. To perfection, I've given the neighboring rooms a full inspection. No one's about, and now at last we may... Aha!